dodge this.
One world currency.
The new world order.
Those are the roots of trouble.
I imagine that right now you're feeling a bit like Alice, tumbling down the rabbit hole. Let me tell you why you're here. You're here because you know something. What you know you can't explain, but you feel it. You felt it your entire life, that there's something wrong with the world. You don't know what it is, but it's there, like a splinter in your mind, driving you mad. It is this feeling that has brought you to me. This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill, the story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want. You take the red pill, you stay in Wonderland. And I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. All I'm offering is the truth, nothing more.
For we are opposed around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy that relies primarily on covert means for expanding its sphere of influence, on infiltration instead of invasion, on subversion instead of elections, on intimidation instead of free choice, on guerrillas by night instead of armies by day. It is a system which has conscripted vast human and material resources into the building of a tightly knit, highly efficient machine that combines military, diplomatic, intelligence, economic, scientific, and political operations. Its preparations are concealed, not published. Its mistakes are buried, not headlined. Its dissenters are silenced, not praised. No expenditure is questioned, no rumor is printed, no secret is revealed. But I am asking your help in the tremendous task of informing and alerting the American people.
And now, welcome to another episode of Down the Rabbit Hole. Here's your host from federaljack.com. It's Popeye.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another live edition of DTRH. It is September 22nd, 2015. On tonight's live edition, I am welcoming back a guest to the show who I have not had on in quite some time. We all know the year has been extremely hectic. I've taken some time off. And actually, the last time she was supposed to be on, it was going to be for my birthday episode here at DTRH back in April. But she was sick, and she could not, like, I remember her throat, she had no voice. And I didn't want to put her through that, and it just would have killed her to drag her on air. So, it's been way too long since she's been on hanging out with me. Now, who could I be talking about that I've been waiting over at least a year to hang out with? None other than my good friend, Heather Callaghan, from Activist Post and Natural Blaze. Let's welcome her back, ladies and gentlemen. Heather, welcome back to the show.
Hey, thanks for having me on again.
It's been way too long, dear. It's been way too long. Every time you come on, you always rock the guests' mind with news about, you know, food freedom and health and information and solutions and positivity. And you're always putting out good energy. So it's good to have you back, honey.
Thanks. I miss your energy, too.
So let's get right into it, because I know there's a ton of stuff that you want to talk about. Before we get into those topics, I want to give you, like, however much time, plug yourself. Because what I want people to do is go ahead and check Heather out on Facebook, Twitter, and everything else she plugs. Follow her, and then as, you know, we're talking and we're talking about subjects, you guys can tweet her, and even if she doesn't respond right away, later on she can respond back or whatnot. I'm doing this more often. I'm making the guests right off the bat plug themselves, so as we go along during the show, and I have you plug yourself as well, Heather, the listeners can, you know, it makes it more of an interactive experience. So go ahead, YouTube, websites, Twitter, Facebook, go.
Gotcha. Okay. I am the co-founder, editor of naturalblaze.com. I write articles there, original articles, weekly. We post great content. I also write for activistpost.com. I've been doing that for 4 years. I've written at least 500 articles, if not more, since 2011. You can find me on Twitter personally. You could follow Natural Blaze on Twitter. You can follow us on Facebook. You can find me on Facebook. We do have a YouTube channel now. Natural Blaze has a YouTube channel. And we have a newsletter, a free newsletter. It goes out 5 days a week. It's packed with lots of great news. And please sign up for the newsletter tonight, because we are offering a free water filter that gets fluoride out of water, which not many filters can do it. And this one is amazing. It leaves the minerals in. And it's the pitcher itself is free. It retails for $70. But you could get the pitcher for free, and then you would have to pay for filters later on. So that part isn't free, but the pitcher itself is free, and it gets fluoride out of your water. So please do that. Please look for that banner in the newsletter when you sign up. And I think that's about it.
And what's your Twitter handle?
Well, Twitter is Natural Blaze, and mine is at Heal YNC. So the word heal and then YNC, heal and see.
Awesome. All right. So everybody go follow her, check her out. You guys can tweet back and forth and everything, and, you know, stay interactive. Pay attention to the articles Heather writes. Like she said, she's written over 500 articles. Really good stuff. She comes on here all the time. She's introduced me to other people and had them come on, like Vernon, to get his story out. There's a lot of stuff that goes on behind the scenes over the course of the past 4 years that I don't think people, the newer people waking up, have been exposed to yet. Heather's a veteran. That's what I'll call you.
Thanks.
You're a veteran warrior for truth and freedom. You really are. That's why you've been on so much. That's why I consider you a friend, or else you wouldn't have been coming on for the birthday show. You know that. Anyway.
Oh, thank you.
So let's get into it. Let's tackle this first subject. You were telling me that you were listening to the show I did back in April about PTS.
Indeed. I just wanted to, for anybody who didn't hear that show, you're wondering why he's calling it PTS. I love that Popeye is not calling it post-traumatic stress disorder, but rather PTS, post-traumatic stress, because I too take an interest in researching that. I don't usually write about it. I don't write about it all the time, but I am interested in the effects of trauma and stress. I mean, as far as like my personal interests go, I don't know why, but I have a giant folder full of information on it. And just as he said, stress can do that to anybody. And researchers, scientists, and biologists know this. They know stress thresholds on human beings and what it does to the brain and central nervous system. But by calling it a disorder, it sounds like it's a mental disorder, something to be afraid of, which the media is driving that point home over and over and over again. But the truth is, there are so many things in our culture, there's so many things today that can induce trauma. There are also solutions to that too.
And, you know, I've thrown out solutions in that show, and I've done other shows about it with my shaman friend, William Whitecrow. He's not only a listener, but a good friend, a hell of an activist, just awesome all around human being. I love William, great guy. And we've talked about it. We did a show about PTS together as well, and we've thrown out solutions. But aside from what I've talked about, what you heard that show, mm-hmm. and you have your own thoughts. You're a very smart young lady. What solutions would you throw out there for people?
Oh, well, first of all, thank you. And secondly, there are so many things that somebody can do to help their body. I do like to look at it in the body now, because you can, talking and therapy and support are all wonderful things, and support is wonderful too, because a lot of times that includes humor, and humor is extremely powerful for removing somebody from maybe feeling victimized or helpless. It helps with acceptance. It's all inclusive. It's just very, very, very powerful. And you notice humor is not a part of totalitarian systems. So that's why the more I look at humor, the more I see that that's a good thing. The other thing is, as far as helping lift yourself out of that area of consciousness, of having been hurt or gone through something very shocking and traumatic. The something that helps people when they can't help themselves is flower essence therapy. And those are flower remedies. It's kind of similar to homeopathy. They were discovered by Dr. Edward Bach in England. And he figured out that flowers have their own kind of energy. And that particular energy is very specifically helps with emotional issues or spiritual problems. You've probably seen one at the store. If you see something called a rescue remedy, those are five flowers that people can use. It's like a tincture. Like if you've been in a car accident, you've just received some bad news, a bit humongous shock, something where your body is in a state of shock or you're very upset. So it could be anything from, you know, your child has a bee sting and they're, you know, they're hysterical, to a breakup, to car accident. I mean, it is an amazing discovery, and I just really cherish flower essence therapy a lot. I love looking them up. I love using them. I use them on a daily basis. Some people also use aromatherapy, which is neat because flower essences are different than essential oils, just so you know. Essential oils is where the plant has been condensed, like maybe like 10,000 roses in one bottle, something like that. But they also have a direct impact on emotions. I would say the flower essence therapy is deeper. And then also deep is homeopathy. People don't usually think of homeopathy as being used for trauma. I have an entire book on it, of which remedies to use for which traumas, kind of removing layers of stuff that we've all been through since we were born into this world. I don't think anyone escapes it. I don't think there's anyone who hasn't gone through something that kind of just sticks around for a while.
What's the title of that book?
Oh, I should have pulled it out right away, but it's, I know you could find it. I would say on Amazon, look for a title that is something like Healing Trauma with Homeopathy. Or wait, here it is. Emotional Healing with Homeopathy. Try that one.
Perfect.
Yeah, it's a great book, but I would also say, I don't trust myself to pick remedies for certain things, so I like to consult with somebody. And if you find somebody who is an expert at homeopathy, or go to a naturopath, or somebody who could test you for what would be the right remedy, you can make a lot of progress in a short amount of time. And because I do not believe that people have to suffer. I mean, grief takes as long as it needs to take, and it's a process. But as far as like being in just daily suffering, a lot of people are really, really just, they think it's a normal, you know, condition to be in for years on end, and to be stuck in one, you know, emotion for years on end might need to do something to release that. And so I look at the emotional realm. I look at your body, your physical body. For one thing, yoga is amazing, and I've been reading all kinds of studies about yoga for PTS, especially for veterans. And it turns out there's another scientific part of yoga as to why it can help somebody with anxiety, any kind of anxiety disorder. And that's because you have a vagus nerve that runs all the way from your brain to your heart through your stomach. So think about how important those things are: your brain, your mental state of mind, your heart, which is very important, and then your digestion. And yoga backbends can actually calm that nerve down. So that's pretty huge, I think. That's something that you could actually tangibly do if you were in a state of anxiety. That's actually something you could actually physically do to try to feel better.
Yeah, I have said on air hundreds of times that yoga is amazing. And even my doctor at my primary at the VA, years ago, he told me, he said, you know, years ago, if you had said to me yoga would help people, I would have laughed at it. And the first time he was told that by somebody, he was like, the veteran said to him, I just started doing yoga for my back problem. And the guy was using a walker. And he was an older Vietnam vet. He was in his early 70s. And my primary is, you know, his doctor as well. And my primary was telling me, because we got into a discussion about yoga, and he can't give you details, but he said, you know, this guy came in and he told me he was going to start doing yoga and see how that worked. And I laughed at it. He said, like an idiot, I went, oh, yoga, because I thought it was just new agey, you know, whatever. He goes, I saw the guy again 6 months later, and he wasn't using a walker. He was using just a cane, and he was walking like, you know, 100% better than he was the last time I saw him. And he could barely even sit. Now he's moving around. He's mobile. And he said, what are you doing? What are you doing that's different? He said, all I do is some basic, simple yoga stretches every day. That's all he did. And he didn't, and I don't even think it was every day. I think it was like 3 days a week he was doing it. 3 or 4 days a week he was doing it. And that was it. And it was just like 45 minutes of some simple, and like I've done, there's a yoga program for veterans called Connected Warriors, where it's free yoga for veterans and active duty. And I'm friends with the people that run it, and I've promoted it before on air, and I've gone to it myself. And it's nothing hardcore yoga. It's like very simple stuff for disabled vets. But I have to tell you, it really helped me out. Like, I can tell you from a personal experience, it helped me physically with a lot of my disabilities, my physical problems that I have with like scar tissue and nerve damage and things like that. And the limitations after having surgeries so many times on my body. So like yoga helped me with that. And my doctor even said to me after this guy came back, he said, I actually recommend to my patients now that they do yoga and they try it as a form of physical therapy before surgery. You know, before they go under the knife to get like a knee, like, you know how they'll say, we'll try physical therapy first. He'll tell them, try yoga and try physical therapy. And if that doesn't work, then surgery should be a last option, not a first option. I mean, his viewpoint, he was already a smart guy, but his view was totally changed, and he was willing to accept this new evidence too to change that viewpoint. So I agree, yoga is an amazing solution.
That is wonderful. Those stories are amazing. Yeah, I mean, so not only can it help you with your physical mobility, but your state of mind too. And at least in my case, like I can personally tell you, I'm still a beginner, and I have a beginning videotape or DVD, and I am just completely elated and full of energy and focus afterward. And it's probably a half hour, 45 minutes, and I don't do it every day. And there's just something about it. I don't know all about why that would be, but it's just, and somebody can become flexible too in just a short amount of time. There's just something about those poses.
Well, it aligns your body. You're stretching your body. You're putting you're stretching things back and putting things back into where they should be. And you're also, it allows you to calm down and release the anxiety and connect back with yourself again. It allows everything to get back into one. Thought, emotion, and action can now become one, and you actually, that's what the Holy Trinity is, right? Mm. Thought, emotion, reaction, that's what Morpheus, Neo, and Trinity in the Matrix actually represent. The point is, you can get back and connect with yourself. You can get back into that connection with everything around you, the universe, and that helps you on a vibrational frequency. You know what I mean? Like you start to vibrate at a different frequency. That's going to help you. If illness, they find that, because everything vibrates on frequencies, they find that certain illnesses, I guess there's like a frequency that lets you know what's wrong with like certain parts of your body or whatever. That's why they say yoga is so healing. It literally helps you change your frequency. And if you're giving off a better vibrational frequency, then you're going to be feeling better. You're going to heal. Now, I'm not saying it's a miracle cure all and you do yoga and cure cancer, but it's one of those things that you have, because of all the crap that we're exposed to, whether it be vaccines or Fukushima radiation, which I want to get your opinion on Fukushima later. But no matter what, all this crap that we're exposed to, you have to take different steps to mitigate the effects of what we're exposed to. And in this case, it would be like post-traumatic stress, which you're exposed to on a daily basis. I mean, it's pumped into your heads when you turn on the television. It's pumped into your head when you listen to music. Everything is violence, violence, sex, violence, right in your face. Very traumatic images. I mean, they used to not show the level of violence and gore that they show on television. There's a show called The Following. Was that the show? The one with the something like that. The one where they Kevin Bacon is in it, and he plays an FBI agent, and there's a guy named Joe Carroll. He's a serial killer, and he's got like some cult followers, and I think that was the show. Well, it was all about serial killing, and like these people would like murder people in very brutal, sadistic ways, like slicing their throats. Like, and when they slit their throat, it'd be like with a huge butcher knife, and it would be live on Fox at 9 o'clock at night. They would never show that when I was a kid. You know, they understood back then how that traumatized people. And they understand that now, too, and that's why they're doing it, because they need to traumatize people. They need to keep people in that level of fear, you know, so they feel isolated and alone, and they're more easily controlled. And yoga, I think, honestly, among other things, meditation, and, you know, a few other things people can say, entheogens, which I believe certain things like that can help if used in the proper way, in certain like ayahuasca ceremonies and things like that. I mean, LSD has been proven to be useful for certain therapeutic needs, MDMA, other things. I think there's a lot more alternative therapies out there for PTS, depending on the level of PTS that you have. You know what I mean? I think it's a case-by-case basis. I don't think anybody should be looked at under an umbrella. You know what I mean? I think that has to be looked at by a case-by-case basis. But I really believe that there are better ways than jamming mind-altering psychotropic drugs down people's throats. What do you think?
Oh, absolutely. I'm looking at another book I have called Nutrition and Your Mind. Well, that was an entire new study by the doctor who wrote it, that was kind of probably a precursor to orthomolecular medicine, which is the idea that nutrition can heal parts of, heal your body and your mind, like your state of mind, because a lot of people are fighting depression, anxiety, trauma every day, whereas it could be so much easier if it turns out that they actually have a vitamin deficiency. That is something that I am, vitamin and amino acid deficiency. So that is something, as far as my own health goes, I'm starting to realize the benefits of seeking nutrition first before anything else, because it's so much easier to be in a better state of mind when that is taken care of. Then I can deal with other stuff. For instance, these psychiatrists, they don't test you. They're not going to test your blood or your urine. They're not going to test for a very simple vitamin deficiency that can lead to mental illness. Like what they would give you psychotropic drugs for, it has a name. It could be tested through someone's urine. It's called pyroluria. And all it is a deficiency in zinc and B6. That's, if you start Googling that, it'll blow your mind. I couldn't wait to write about it. I'm going to try to soon, but I tell everybody I know about it, because a lot of people have this problem, and it's more than that. I mean, it has to do with protein and something in your blood, but this could be figured out through a simple urine test, and yet nobody gets it. They're just supposed to go and get heavy duty medicine, and which doesn't cure their problem. Yet there's a lot of women who've been diagnosed as severely mental disorder, bipolar, borderline personality disorder, schizophrenia, deep, severe ADHD. And as it turns out, there was this issue of pyroluria, which has very specific symptoms that are physical in nature. But they're not taught to look at that. And, you know, this Nutrition in Your Mind is a wonderful book to have, because it talks about blood sugar making people go crazy. You know, I didn't mean it in a derogatory way. I just mean like making people act very erratic or suddenly suicidal. Or the book starts out with the story of a doctor calling this other doctor who was into nutritional psychology because his wife walked out into the road to try to kill herself. And all it was, her blood sugar had dropped, and she all of a sudden felt doom and gloom. Felt like, this is the end. I have to end my life. I'm not saying that's the case for everybody, but I'm just saying if there were ever a chance that these issues could be physical problems, you would think that that would be the first thing to run to. But the health fields have been segregated on purpose. They are completely segregated when they're supposed to be integrated. So really, being an MD and a psychiatrist, ideally, if they were really, really going to help people, they would be, you know, working together, possibly, and referring to each other, maybe. And as far as taking our current situation in America and making it the most ideal, because a lot of them do help people, that would be ideal.
Well, I honestly believe a lot of the issues that people have are chemical reactions to a lot of the crap that's in the foods. You know, hyperactivity, they say hyperactivity in kids is caused by like red dye and other things. Well, what other effects is that having on adults? You know, plus all the vaccines, all that, who knows how that's altering people's minds, right? Then, of course, there's the exposure to the radiation, which radiation exposure actually causes mental problems. So, there's like a lot of factors at work going on here. And I think nutrition is one of the number one things to help mitigate the effects of all that. Ladies and gentlemen, stay tuned. 3 short minutes. Heather and I will be right back. Don't go anywhere. Ladies and gentlemen, we are back. So I want to get right back into it. Heather, when we went to break, we were talking about nutrition and solutions and how we both agree that even with the exposure to all this crap, you know, radio frequencies, radiation, PTS, you know, fear, the vaccines, the crap in the food, the first step is to fix yourself from within. And that would be nutrition and the kind of vitamins and stuff that we intake. And ladies and gentlemen, that goes right along with what I always say, the law of correspondence in the micro out into the macro. That's where that little term the Masons run with, as above, so below, the whole Washington Monument with the reflecting pool, as above, so below. That's what that is. That's the law of correspondence. What you do within will change the world without. So, Heather, you were very eloquent when you said earlier that you can't fix the world and you can't do, you know, you can't take on any of these other things if you're not healthy. And that includes mentally, spiritually, and physically, you know, with what we intake for our bodies to run as biological machines. So that was very eloquently put before.
Thank you. I think also that we need to start looking at other things in our life, maybe in a dietary sense. Like we need to start looking at what we expose ourselves to as though it's becoming a part of us, either by absorption or, you know, in a dietary way, or maybe like a bank account sort of way, maybe. Because we get exposed to a lot of things that aren't food related or imagery related. I mean, it's just when you go down the rabbit hole and you start looking at all the things that people, if they're so-called awake or in the know about certain things that could be dangerous to their health, then it starts to become apparent. It starts to make you feel like you're under attack. And I know that when I feel like I'm under attack, that can create more problems. And so in order to feel like you're not under attack, it helps to take charge and take control over your own life, what you do have control over. And the rest can go on the back burner for a while and until you're at a place where you could deal. If like, for instance, if you want to change, raise awareness about Fukushima or change something bigger, something systemic, well, you could. Those are good things to do. I believe that is a good thing to do. And you keep trying to help yourself. You make sure you know who you are, and then get other people too. Actually, you don't even have to wait. Do both of them at the same time. But it's very hard to do any of it if you feel helpless. And I can relate to that. But the more that you just step up and take charge of your own life and start regarding things you get exposed to as though you're ingesting it. You know, for instance, like television. I don't look at it as really so much entertainment anymore. I look at it as a deficit, kind of, or something that could be harmful. And that way, you know, when I attempt to cut it out of my life, I don't feel deprived of it. I feel like I'm doing something good for myself, because to expose myself to the types of imagery that we were just talking about is detrimental to my health, in my opinion, for me.
Well, let's get into that, because that segues into one of the things that you've been writing about and one of the things that I wanted to talk to you about tonight is the effect that TV actually has on our minds. And we were discussing how it can traumatize you, and it can literally induce PTS. I mean, they used it on 9/11 to induce PTS just by showing you those images over and over and over again. I mean, that's how people across the country were traumatized by an event that happened in New York City, because they went to the videotape. That's why. And they do it every day with TV. Like I said earlier, that show The Following is a really great example. I mean, when I was a kid, they didn't, and it's not saying that there wasn't something going on behind the scenes back then. There was. But they weren't at that level yet where they could put that out there and people wouldn't be outraged. If you had put that show where they're literally cutting people's throats and you're seeing the throat being slit open and the blood pour out and the person gurgling and you hear them going, okay, like to that level, that depth, okay, they would never air that. That was on like HBO, and even HBO wouldn't air that until like after 10 or 11 o'clock at night. You just didn't see it. It was not on during the hours that young children would be up. It just was not done. And now it's on at 9 o'clock at night on Fox, where if you have basic cable package, you're going to see it. And it makes you, you really have to step back and go, well, why would they do that? They know, because like I'm old enough to know why they didn't air that when I was a kid. So you have to look at it and go, why would they air that? Because they have to know that's going to induce trauma. Well, bingo, that's why they do it, because they need to keep inducing trauma and keep making you afraid. That's the whole point. Heather, what say you?
Oh, definitely. And I mean, a lot of us have thought in the past, like, now, why do they do that? Why do they have to put that part in the show? Or sometimes a teenager will be like, can I see this? There's just one part in the show. And then you look back and you think, why in the last 30 years has everything gotten so much worse as far as what's on television? Yeah, good question. Why? Because it's really senseless. There's gratuitous violence and everything. There's no reason for it. It's almost like it was incrementally done, you know, to get you used to more and more and more violence, because the elderly people who are alive today did not watch blood and gore on television and did not let their children watch that while they were eating at the dinner table. And I'll tell you something that will really blow your mind. Speaking of September 11th and what happened, well, after September 11th, there was an influx of food allergies, certain food allergies. And the reason I know this is because there's a way to eliminate food allergies called NAET therapy, and it's NAET.com. It stands for Nambudrapads. I may have said that wrong. Nambudrapads Allergy Elimination Techniques. And the woman who brought this to America was in California and noticed all of a sudden an influx of allergies she was treating. Eggs, wheat, coffee, breakfast foods, right? Well, September 11th happened around 9:30 Eastern Standard Time, but that would have been 6:30 on the West Coast. Everybody was watching that over breakfast, and trauma can have a way of giving you an allergy to food, because your body is, your immune system reacts, and your body is kind of looking for something to say, you know, it's this is the reason I have this problem. You know, like if you're holding an apple, this is the way one of our contributing writers is a naturopath. His name is Dr. Scott Graves. He told me this, that if, you know, if you are holding an apple and you get the worst news of your life, your body's going to kind of blame the apple, so to speak, and find something outside that could be the reason. So you might have an allergy, and food allergies are on a very wide spectrum. It could be something you never even know you have. For instance, like maybe vitamin C, a lot of people have vitamin C allergy, and so they might not process it at all. It might just sit there in their body. So that has been, I've done NAAT therapy, and it's been amazing for my health. And sometimes I wonder about, you know, was I eating certain foods while I was watching a movie? You know, how did I develop this allergy? Well, there you go. I mean, television can do that. Something else that I wrote about recently, aluminum, which I know you're probably going to talk about later, but aluminum can induce food allergies too. And so it's funny because everything we've been talking about tonight is connected, completely connected. And another thing that connects them all is digestion. And that is the big topic of the day, because you really cannot sustain yourself without digestion. And we know all the things that we get exposed to on a daily basis can very much affect digestion in a very bad way. And that in turn can damage your health and your mental outlook on life and your ability to function, concentrate, function. The list goes on. So I don't know where to go back now, but I got off on a tangent, but everything we've been talking about is connected.
Well, your stomach, what you were just talking about with your stomach is considered our second brain.
Mm-hmm.
And the stomach and the brain are actually in constant communication with one another. So if one's not operating properly, the other one's going to have to pick up the slack, and then it's not going to be operating properly because it's not getting the proper set of signals from, you know, the other one. So,
yeah,
you know, it's like a car. If one major piece isn't operating properly, it's guaranteed to eventually affect other pieces of the vehicle. So we have to actually start to – people maintain their vehicles better than they maintain their own bodies. In many, many cases, it's almost like it's almost like the media's gotten them to convince them that the car is more important than their own physical well-being. Oh,
yeah.
Actually, did that? But they've gotten people to love material things more than humanity itself. And I don't mean you have to just love yourself and not care about anybody else. But if you had a clear head and weren't, if people were not you, you know what I mean? If people had, society in general, had less of a love of things and more of a love of humanity, they might be more apt to focus on making themselves better because they would understand the law of correspondence and they would understand as above, so below, in the micro, out in the macro. And they would understand that in order to affect better change in the world, they have to change themselves for the better.
Yeah, absolutely. And if you know, the sooner you can break through the lies, the happier you'll be. I mean, you don't have to be happy either. You don't have to be. That's another concept that's been foisted on us, is the idea that there's something wrong with you if you're not happy. But look around. If you're happy, if you look around and you're completely happy, doesn't that say there's something wrong? I mean, you don't have to be one or the other. You can just be you. And but the lie is that you need to fill this void up with certain things, and then it's a distraction away from the more important things of life. And but the truth is, I mean, if only people knew how amazing they actually were, how much power they have, then they wouldn't even have to worry about trying to fight off certain things, like, you know, maybe a food addiction, or, you know, I need to stop buying such and such or whatever. It might not even be a problem anymore, because you wouldn't feel bad about yourself to begin with. And television is wonderful for making you feel very terrible about yourself. And I'm not just talking about advertisements. I'm talking about storylines.
You're right. You know, if you sit and think about it, as I sit here, and if you sit and think about it, probably I would say 85 to 90%, if not more, of the television programming. Pay attention to that word, ladies and gentlemen. Programming. Why don't they call it television? I don't know. Why don't they call it television shows, television broadcasting, television streaming? Why the word programming? You should think about that. But 85 to 90% of the television programming out there, I would say, gets us to hate ourselves.
Yeah, definitely. And when also something I didn't mention in my articles about television was that when you're up against your very core beliefs, I mean, a lot of the time your firewall while you're watching television, this when that is down, it's completely down. As much as people think they can consciously think through it, that is not how television works. I know this for a fact. It's your subconscious speaks in images. So it doesn't matter how many times you consciously tell yourself something that's silly, that's not real. Your body doesn't believe it because it is communicating. You're being communicated to without even knowing it. That's the creepy part about it. That's why stories are used. Stories, imagery, metaphors are used because that is the only language that your subconscious knows. That's the only way to reach it. But when you're being told something through imagery that you don't believe in, that you believe in is wrong, like, you know, adultery, let's say, which is huge. It happens all the time on television and movies. And let's say that goes against your core beliefs. It's going to cause some stress inside of you. But you got to wonder what wins in the end. Carl Jung believed that the subconscious wins in the end. He didn't believe that it was 95% of your functioning was done based on beliefs of your subconscious. He believed it was all of it. So, well, he did in a way, but for the most part, yes, because he really believed that people were, this was his book about being an individual. In case anyone's interested, he wanted people to be individuals first and stop being mass men. Don't be a mass man, he always said, because that's what television does. It creates masses. In fact, scientifically speaking, when you're watching a movie together with somebody, your brains are synced up. Literally, they are synced up. And it only takes about 15 seconds of imagery or television before your brains are synced up. How creepy is that? Some people were trying to pass it off like that meant you were more bonded. But let's be honest, we're not bonded with each other when we watch movies. But imagine being in a movie theater and your brain is synced up with every single brain in that room just because you're glued to the same screen. The same parts of your brain are being lit up. Now, you can't tell me that happens when two people are reading a book, two different books, you know, in a room. I would venture to think that that's not the case. The what you're watching on the TV is lighting up certain parts of your brain, and you're none the wiser for it. So stress hormones. Everybody's talking about cortisol belly. You need this hormone. And for some reason in the Western world, especially in the last 10 years, we're just overdosing on it to the point of major detrimental health problems, stress-induced diseases. We're talking about PTS levels of cortisol that can lead to brain dysfunction, a damaged thyroid, which you need if you want to withstand radiation in your environment, obesity, blood sugar problems, chronic fatigue, immune dysfunction, impaired healing, kind of like what a diabetic gets, insomnia, weakness. Those are all horrible things. Well, that can happen when you're watching not only trauma on television, but when you're also up against all these things that are challenging your beliefs all the time. But the trauma could lead to trauma in general can lead to brain fog and literal shrinking of your hippocampus. That is a part of your brain, very important part of your brain, that's responsible for creating new memories. They call them time-sequenced memories. That is an important part of PTS. And adrenal fatigue, when you're pumping out these stress hormones, adrenaline, that's right above your kidneys. Adrenal fatigue, or rather I should say stress hormones are being pumped out while you're watching TV without you knowing it. Because if you were hooked up to a brain scan or some kind of body scan, even though you're telling yourself you're not really watching a bloody war or some guy getting his throat cut, like that happens all the time on television now, even though you can tell yourself it's not real, your body doesn't believe you because your stress hormones are being released. And your stress hormones can also be released when you're watching something that is triggering maybe something in your own past, something unpleasant maybe, a memory. You might not be wise to that either. You might not notice that maybe your chest is feeling more tense, or your breathing is getting a little more rapid, or your blood pressure is going up because you're seeing something that's triggering something, or something you don't like or don't believe in, or something that's just horrible to watch. And then what do? We're just sitting there. But, you know, we're sitting there going through fight or flight, and we're constantly sitting through fight or flight. Nature has a way of dealing with fight or flight besides fight or flight. For instance, rabbits have a way of dealing with adrenaline rush. If a rabbit is caught in a trap, and let's say it gets loose from the trap or it escapes a predator, when the rabbit is finally safe, it's going to run around in circles like it's crazy. And it looks crazy if you've ever seen it. Some people have told me about what it looks like. They zip around almost like somebody's whipping them around on a leash or something, but it's them running around in lightning fast circles. They're doing that to burn it off. That's how they deal with fight or flight. When they finally get safe, they've got all this adrenaline in their body now. Well, they burn it off by running around in circles. But what do? We just keep sitting.
Wow. Wow, dude, you're making my brain explode right now. So, is there like a spot? Do you have a list of all the horrific side effects of us having this, like being exposed to this constantly on a daily basis? Do you know of the side effects at all?
Well, I wrote a couple articles about television that just basically scratched the surface about stress hormones. It's an area I'd love to learn more about, but I just know that that when you're exposed to imagery like that, I kind of connected the trauma with the stress hormones. And I do know that your body doesn't believe you, even if you say it's not real. It just doesn't, because of all the other studies that have shown what is happening to your body while you're watching a movie. So if you go to Natural Blaze or Activist Posts, the title is How TV Affects Your Brain Chemistry for the Worst, Part 2. I said worst, even though grammatically it's worse, but I figured it was really bad, so I said How TV Affects Your Brain Chemistry for the Worst. And then I have those symptoms that I just told you, and what it does when it shrinks that part of your brain, when trauma itself shrinks that part of your brain. But my argument is, you're watching trauma all the time. You don't know the difference, even though you consciously tell yourself that that's not really happening. I think it's triggering something in your body. And you could tell, because if you were hooked up to a stress test, it would be showing that. Just the same way that scientists can figure out your brains are synced up when you're watching a movie. And I have a book called The Plug-In Drug, which talks about it's not so much the content of TV, but it's television itself, the hypnotic. So that book was updated. It's on Amazon. That deals with why TV itself is dangerous, the hypnotic ways of television. But then there was a guy named Jerry Mander who wrote 4 Arguments for the Elimination of Television. He wrote more the abstract stuff. He wrote more about the damaging effects of the imagery and the storylines. And even in these, both of these books were first written in the 70s, and even then they caught on to not only the hypnotic effect of television, but in Jerry Mander's book, he has a whole chapter on death culture. And this is the 70s. That's about 40 years ago, at least. And it's, death culture back then. What is it like now? Everything is geared toward death. What a lovely thing for your entertainment. that's entertainment.
We live in death culture. It's like it's worshipped. That again, that show, The Following, it's about a serial killer, and that every show is at least two or three people are, you know, sadistically killed. And people are like, oh, I can't wait to see the next episode. It's a great show. Like, think about that. Or the show The Walking Dead.
Yeah.
Literally, where, like, most of the people in the show are zombies, and they're literally walking dead. Death, death, dead, death, skeletons, skulls, death, 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 death. And look, I have a couple tattoos with skulls and stuff in them. They're old. That's different. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the overabundance. I mean, even that Kesha song that came out like a year ago where she said she was forced to sing the lyrics even though she didn't agree with it, the one that was titled Die Young.
Mm-hmm.
And it was just a bunch of them. The whole video was a bunch of young kids dancing around in a barn that was surrounded by the cops and the SWAT team, and they were about to get all shot by the cops. And it was pretty much the lyrics were, I want to die young. That was the lyrics. And this was like a top 40 song, and some people were criticizing her. And she said, oh, I didn't want to sing the song. I was forced to. Well, gee, who has the power to force a pop music star to sing such horrible lyrics to twist the minds of children? Oh, that would be the record companies. And they are connected to other people higher up in the food chain. I guess that would be a conspiracy, right? By definition, two or more people getting together to do something bad. Oh, there you go.
That's right.
And by the way, I knew about the whole trauma thing, but you really did. Like, that wasn't radio hyperbole. You actually blew my mind with the rabbit thing. I didn't know that the rabbits were smart enough to run around and burn off that excess adrenaline. So, see, exercise, ladies and gentlemen.
Mm-hmm.
Go out for a walk. When you're stressed, go out for a walk. That's all you got to do. Be like the rabbit. You know, you know how Bruce Lee was like, be like water. Well, be like rabbit. Go out and burn off some of that energy. That's actually, you know, there you go. We can learn so much from nature if we actually just connected back to it instead of thinking that we should lord over it and
control
it and murder it and, you know, rape and pillage it, basically. We have like a minute before we go to break, Heather. Actually, we've got about 45 seconds now. Really quick, throw out the title of that the article about the TV again.
Okay, on naturalblaze.com or activistpost.com or even a Google search, how TV affects your brain chemistry for the worst. And this, the one I was reading off of, was part two.
Interesting stuff, ladies and gentlemen. I told you, Heather's an amazing, amazing, amazing vault of info, especially when it comes to health. I go to her often for information. Go check her out over on Activist Post, Natural Blaze. Follow her on Twitter, Facebook, and everywhere else. We will be back 3 short minutes. Stay tuned, another hour. Ladies and gentlemen, we are back with hour number two here on tonight's live edition of Down the Rabbit Hole. I am your host, Popeye, from federaljack.com, popeyeradio.com, and of course my YouTube archive, DTRH Radio Archives. That's Delta Tango Romeo Hotel Radio Archives over on YouTube. Check it out. Ladies and gentlemen, tonight I've been chatting with my good friend, author, researcher, and all-around awesome human being, Heather Callaghan. Heather, welcome back for hour number two, dear.
Thanks.
So, plug yourself shamelessly, plug everything really quick again. Go ahead, where everybody can follow your work and what you do.
Thank you. Please go to my website, naturalblaze.com. That's Natural Blaze is in blazing a trail to natural health, because that's what we want to do, is help you to blaze your own trail and empower yourself with solutions for natural health and news and tips and all sorts of good things over there. And please sign up for our newsletter today. Please do it, because not only will you get lots of great stories every weekday, but we are running a banner ad for a free pitcher, water filter that gets fluoride out of the water. And there's not many of those out there, and this one actually leaves the minerals in, and the only thing is shipping and paying for replacement filters. That's it. So that's $70 pitcher for free. And you can find us on Twitter and Facebook, Natural Blaze.
Awesome. Okay. So there's a bunch of topics I want to get into hour number two. We're going to shift gears a little bit. It's still in health and freedom and everything. But a couple other things that you've been writing about other than PTS. And if you're just joining us in hour number two, I suggest you go back in the archives either here on YouTube or PopeyeRadio.com and you go and listen to it. So let's get into this first article. Is North Carolina requiring barcodes for backyard chicken owners? What?
Yes. The answer is yes. They are. I haven't checked where they are currently with this issue, but as far as I can see, they are still doing this. And it's all because of bird flu outbreaks that happened in the Midwest, which is nowhere near North Carolina. And they're using these emergency outbreaks to install plans and surveillance. But the weird thing is they're purposely targeting people with backyard chickens. And it has got people so upset and so angry. In fact, you can go to a Facebook group called No to NC Chicken Registration. And they will keep you updated on everything the North Carolina governor is doing and the Department of Agriculture. But what this is, they're targeting backyard chicken owners as though they need to be watched, especially because of bird flu outbreaks. Which is pretty ridiculous, but they are trying to get all poultry owners, even if you own one chicken, to register online for an NC farm ID number. So yes, you will have a farm ID. So it's actually, I think it's more like you're getting the barcode. That's what it looks like. It doesn't matter how many birds are owned, you have to go and get this ID number. And they're enforcing all these rules on North Carolina now, and you know, no selling chickens and birds at bird shows during certain times. I mean, it's just kind of getting to be a little draconian over there. And they keep trying to say this is about your health, this is about everybody's public safety, this is the safety for the birds. But people are like, well, what are you going to do for my bird when it keels over with bird flu? How are you going to protect my bird if it should get sick? Well, you can't, because with avian bird flu, it's, you know, your chicken is dead, basically. So they can't really do anything for it. So the people who have backyard chickens kind of know what's up. They know what's up. This is about tracking people, and they are afraid that these ag workers are going to start coming onto their property, and they don't want that. And even though they keep saying they're not, sorry, but previous activity of health departments or various governmental departments trashing people's property, killing animals, throwing out food, stuff that I started out writing about and still am very passionate about, there's a very big, long, damaging wake that the government has created for small-time farmers and individuals. It's not pretty at all. And I am not surprised that people are up in arms about this. The fact that they're targeting backyard chickens is ridiculous, because I interviewed Alvin Schlangen, who's been targeted 3 times in Minnesota. Now, he does happen to live right next to where this outbreak was going on, but it was almost like he was on a list. And they visited him, and they're like, you can't deliver eggs, and they try to do all this stuff. His chickens are fine. It's the big factory farm chickens and poultry that is keeling over dead, and not very surprising when they're all, you know, thousands and thousands of them are on top of each other in a confinement. Well, that might be your problem right there. With the backyard chickens, people are taking precautions with them. But they, in my opinion and Alvin Schlangen's opinion, stand a better chance, especially when people are using extra help, natural help, to help their chickens too. And they're taking better sanitary precautions. But why would backyard chickens be the ones being targeted? And something that I told Popeye before, obviously this never has anything to do with health and public safety ever. But one thing I told him was, you know, North Carolina is like the biggest state for factory farms, especially poultry. I mean, it's humongous. It's like the Mecca in America. So, I mean, the Midwest had them too and got a lot of theirs wiped out. But this outbreak is very strange. It's leading to rising grocery costs. It used to be the egg was the cheapest thing you could ever eat. And they keep telling us the prices are going to go up. But to think that this would be an opportunity to trample on people with backyard chickens is ridiculous.
Ironically, an egg is commonly referred to as nature's perfect food for the body. Isn't it interesting that there's an attack on something that could be considered nature's perfect food for the human body? Interesting.
Yeah, and interesting that you say attack, because I'm sorry, I'm going to get called a conspiracy theorist, but I don't care. This talk about synchronicity, because here I was writing that story, and I was wondering, where did this influenza come up all of a sudden, and why are backyard chicken owners being targeted, and this is all just so strange? Well, there's a book here I have called Lab 257. Now, this is about Plum Island, and I picked this up because of I wanted to read about the origins of Lyme disease, which is pretty much openly admitted that Lyme disease comes from Plum Island because of the USDA researchers playing around with bioweapons. And, you know, I won't say, you know, for sure what happened with how Lyme escaped into the populace, but it's like the biggest epidemic right now. And it's something I passionately research in my spare time. And this book was written by a Harvard graduate, Michael Christopher Carroll. So here I am thinking I'm going to be reading about Lyme, and the very first chapters is talking about Project Operation Paperclip, bringing Nazi scientists, the head Nazi scientists over here onto Plum Island. And what is the Nazi scientist doing first? He's studying avian viruses. He's creating avian viruses in the 1950s.
Eric Traub.
That's his name.
Yep.
That's his name. That's exactly the guy I'm talking about. And he killed a lot of chickens to do that.
Moving that facility to Kansas.
Are you kidding me?
No. And
well, they closed it down.
I drove past it when I went out on my road trip with Radchick back in April. Her and I, on the way back, we drove past it on the highway. We were going past where the facility and is going to be the new one. And it's out in the middle of like the breadbasket of America. And you got to wonder, why did they move it? Why would you move a facility with all sorts of weird diseases and things going on inside of jars that they admit get out, by the way? When there was stuff getting back to the mainland when it was on an island off of the mainland. You think moving it to the mainland is going to be more secure and not have things leak out? And it just happens to be right by where what you consider the breadbasket of America is? But yeah, I can't foresee any problems. No. I can't foresee anything going wrong there.
Yeah. And I just got to credit Alan Watt, because he's always, he kind of inspired me to look into these studies more and look at them a different way. And it's just funny because he's always talking about how they're always going, whoops, making people scared to death. I'm not really laughing because it's not that funny, but I'm laughing at the humor of, you know, that it always looks like they're doing something by accident. And then they keep demanding that the public trust all the time. And there's something wrong with you if you don't trust the government, but they're always going, whoops, you know, this vial broke open. I mean, even Stephen King wrote The Stand, and that's exactly what happened. Well, I can't tell you how many things scientists are doing recently that are very similar to The Stand. You know, what started with The Stand, with the outbreak. And I cannot tell you how many things in Netflix or everything I'm coming across is revolving around outbreaks. The idea that everybody's going to get wiped out, or that you could get wiped out, or antibiotics won't help, or oops, the CDC center found some old smallpox, you know. And there's only two places that are allowed to have smallpox, according to the UN, America and Russia. Well, obviously, it's not for vaccine research. It's a bioweapon. I mean, they're the ones treating it like a bioweapon. You know what I mean? Only Russia and America are allowed to have them. Why? And why have them at all? And so recently, people are getting freaked out about the scientists who in Russia are going to dig deep and get a monster disease out of this ice, right? No problems. You know, let's just bring up this really monster thing. They're going to do that, bring up a pathogen that they don't know anything about, apparently. There's nothing, we don't have any sort of antidote or way of dealing with a 30,000-year-old disease, but we're supposed to just trust that it's okay, right? But of course that is to inspire or instill fear in people.
Is this the Franken virus that you wrote about?
Yes.
What's the title of that article? Because I know you sent that to me.
Yes. A girl wrote about the virus, and I tied it into an old X-Files episode. So I'm pulling it up right now, but
here it is. 30,000-year-old virus to be resurrected played out in the X-Files, question mark. So
yeah.
You were able to tie all this. This is really a good article, and this is creepy. This is one of those, why are they digging up viruses that are dormant? Like, hello? What's that old expression? Let sleeping dogs lie?
Yeah, and that's the thing. Like, this is the weird thing. So the scientists do that, and everybody's freaking out about it, of course. People are upset. People are like, that's not a good idea. And then they go back to the public and play it off like, you're just a little public. Trust the scientists to do this. But we know that they don't have anything to deal with this, right? But we can't destroy smallpox when supposedly there is something to deal with it. Wink, wink, you know, a vaccine, right? So then all these articles start coming out defending the scientists and talking about how to destroy something would be detrimental. To destroy smallpox would be detrimental. They don't say how. They're just telling the public, we can't do that. That could be detrimental. We need it for further research. What if something happens? Well, if you're trying to eradicate the disease in people, supposedly, what would be the problem with destroying the vial if you're trying to eradicate the disease? They can never answer it. They won't. And they won't. They will tell you that they have to because there could be something bad that happens up ahead. They never tell you what it is.
I love when they say, well, terrorists could get their hands on it and replicate it. Well, hold on. You guys are the ones digging it up. So if you're so worried that terrorists are going to get, first of all, where are they going to get all the equipment and the information about where it's at? Oh, because perhaps you're referring to your bosses when you say the terrorists are going to dig it up and use it on the general. Oh, you're talking about what you're actually going to do with it. Okay.
Yeah, no kidding. And one of the last people to die of smallpox, by the way, was the lab created one, and it was in 1978 in England, and it was an accident, and the scientist was working on it, and the only thing that this is the official story is that it floated into the air ducts to a woman who was studying up in a building. She died from it. Her mom got it. Another member of the family got it. They lived, but she died. She was young. And so the part of the story that people don't hear about is that supposedly the scientist was so distraught that he committed suicide when his wife wasn't looking, with rusty shears in the backyard, cutting into himself with rusty shears. Okay, that's a little strange. That's just strange. Before the press showed up, you know, he supposedly killed himself because he felt so bad that this disease got out. I'm sorry. I just find that very odd. It's like, see, the only reason people know that they were fooling around with it was because this girl died from it. That was an accident, but it also kind of let everybody know that they were working on it when they didn't need to be working on it. They were supposedly going to declare the world smallpox free in, you know, just a couple years, but here they were drudging it up again.
There's no need to be doing this. They did this with the like the Spanish flu too or something. They dug it up a couple of years, I don't know, 5-6 years ago, whatever the hell it was now. They dug it up and they were like, "Whoa, Al Qaeda could get it." Really? Like maybe you guys should stop them before they even get the how could they get the idea to go up into like the middle of Nowheresville in the middle, I think it was the North Pole or Alaska or whatever the hell it was. And they were literally digging up old Eskimo bodies from like 100 years ago of the people that have died from the Spanish flu. And I get what if something there was, I think there was one other thing that they were looking for too. And they dug the bodies up and they actually like found the DNA of this thing and they got it out. And they're like, well, it's important because terrorists could use it. But you guys just would dug up the only version of it. So how are terrorists going to get it? Question mark. You know what I'm saying? Like,
yeah.
You know, like, hello? Like, oh.
But you're just supposed to believe it. You're just supposed to believe that they're the authority and you're not. And it's like, how can people have so much blind trust if they keep messing up over and over and over again? People are, you know, get sick. They don't have anything that actually works against the diseases that they say they do. And we're just supposed to support the idea that some people are just going to have to go. I mean, because that's what the end conclusion is. They're like, oh, we have an antibiotic crisis, you know, and they're scaring people. Well, if you read enough of these things and you step back, you're going to see that it's urgent. It's all about urgency. It's all about fear. So I'm amazed at people who have so much faith and they're so positive about advancements, because I don't think there's anything advanced about, you know, how we do things here. All this stuff. I don't think there's anything great or advanced about it. I think it's about sickness. And the kind of predictive programming that comes up on television not only 20 years ago when this X-Files episode first aired, but now especially, goodness gracious, the outbreaks. That's how I view the whole zombie thing. I was just talking to somebody and I said, you know, Walking Dead makes me really uncomfortable because I'm kind of getting the message. The constant message in the pilot episode is they're not your family anymore. You have to shoot them through the head because they're not really who they are anymore. Getting people to shoot their own family members because they're not themselves anymore and it's a disease. And I mean, it's kind of a creepy analogy, creepy metaphor, if you ask me.
Desensitizing the general population.
Mm-hmm.
Well, they see us as the Walking Dead. Anyway, they see
us. That's what I think.
It's a very esoteric thing on a much deeper level. Mark Passio and I have talked about this.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, the last show him and I did together about 4 or 5 months ago, we talked about this. And I see zombie movies as a little bit different. I see them looking at the general public as the Walking Dead, as all the zombies, and they think they're the survivors in it, you know?
Yeah.
And they're going to make it through, and we're just all brainless zombies. And they call us literally the Walking Dead because we're disconnected from nature and each other and the universe and our own souls. We're not connected. And, you know, ladies and gentlemen, when I say that, I'm not picking on you. Just so you know, I'm not going, anyway, we're not connected because you're a bunch of jerk-offs and me, me, me. I'm not picking on you. I'm pointing out a problem so that we can address said problem. But we have to all admit that there is a problem. And somebody has to be able to point it out. Okay? We can't all jump on people and get angry at them sometimes and be like, well, you know, blah, 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 you know. I don't think there's an issue. Don't be negative. Try to be politically correct. That's the programming. Okay, take political correctness and flush it down the toilet. Everybody take a breather and realize that there is a problem. It's like if you went to the doctor and he said, hey, look, there's an issue. You have this, you know, like, say you went to a homeopath, right? And they're like, look, you have this problem, and this is how we're going to correct it, whatever it may be. Whether you believe that the problem is going to affect you or not, it's going to affect you. Whether you know about it or not, it's going to affect you. How it affects you relies on whether or not you know about it or not and whether or not you respond to it accordingly. So I think it's important to discuss all of this, and I think it's important to lay all this stuff out on the table and talk about it in an open and honest fashion. So I'm not picking on anyone. I don't want anybody to, sometimes I come off like I'm a dick. I know. So I don't want anybody thinking I'm picking on them when I say things. Look, the programming that you've been put through, that I was put through, that Heather was put through, we're all exposed to the same garbage. It's that crap that comes across the television. It's the crap that we're fed in schools. It's the crap that comes across the radio broadcasting networks. Well, that used to come across it until some of us have taken over the airwaves and we're putting out truth and we're putting out real information. You know? I mean, everybody's been through the same thing. So don't let it get to you, because that's a big stumbling block. A lot of people get upset that they didn't know about this, and that's part of getting over your own ego. Like, when I first found out about 9/11, and when I first realized it, when I first was able to get over my PTS of that day and the event, and I looked at it, I understood it, and I was like, oh my God, my firefighter kicked in, my fire investigator kicked in, and I realized what was going on, and I started to go, wow, that's an explosion, oh my God. And I realized very quickly that I had to get over my own ego of, well, I should have known this. How come I didn't? You know, I had to let go of that, not bash myself for it. And I had to get over it so I could focus on the real problem at hand. So that's why I wanted to sidetrack for a second, because it's always an important thing to throw out there and highlight. And I went through it, and I still go through it with certain subjects sometimes when you find something new, maybe that clashes with your own old belief system. It's called change, ladies and gentlemen. And as long as it's in a positive manner and you're changing yourself for the better and you're changing the world around you for the better, then that's not a bad thing at all. Heather, we got about 2 minutes. What say you?
Oh, definitely. And I hate to see people feel down and overwhelmed. And I just want to encourage you that you can always turn the clock. I mean, you can always turn your life around. Like if you feel like you had a lot of programming and everything, it's surprising how fast you can get rid of it. You don't have to spend as much time getting rid of it as you did going through it. Even though you couldn't help it. Well, first of all, you should forgive yourself because you couldn't help it. When you were a kid, we were all born into a pack of lies. Pretty much every generation has been. And the fact that you know this much and you've come this far is an amazing feat as far as the history of mankind is concerned, that you are a conscious being. And being that, you can let that stuff go. You can get the old programming and everything. You let your body process it, get it out of your system, and take yourself out of that and, you know, do the things that are important to you in life. That's what I think.
I agree. No, well said. You hit the nail right on the head. Look, people, just the only way I can describe it is how I have it tattooed on the side of my neck. Be the change. But you have to actually believe in it, and you have to do it. You have to be that change in your own life, and then you'll emanate that. Like, you, if you don't have your stuff straight, you can't expect to be able to juggle this monstrosity of what's going on in the world. And there's nothing wrong with getting your stuff straight, because then you put out a better vibe, a better energy into the universe, and then you physically, literally are being the change that you wish to see in the world. See how that works? All right, 3 short minutes. We'll be right back. Go check Heather out. Make sure you follow her over on Twitter. I'm going to make her shamelessly plug her stuff one more time when we come back. Don't go anywhere. Ladies and gentlemen, we are back. Final segment. Wow. 2 hours went by in the blink of an eye. Heather, do me a favor. Shamelessly plug all your stuff again. And make sure you give your Twitter handle out there that so people can follow you over on Twitter. Because I know there are some people asking me what exactly your Twitter handle is. So go ahead.
Okay. Well, find my writing and my work at naturalblaze.com. You can also check out activistpost.com. I do post different articles on both websites. Sign up for our newsletter on naturalblaze.com, and also check out the offer for a free water filter that can filter fluoride. You can find Natural Blaze on Twitter and Facebook, Natural Blaze, just like that. And then my personal Twitter is HealYNC, So it's Heal Lin C, or He Lin C. And then I'm on Facebook too, and I'm one of Popeye's friends. So if you're Popeye's friend, you can find me, but I'm Heather Callaghan, and that's about it.
Awesome. Okay. So there's two more things I want to get in with you here in the final segment. And I know we'll probably veer off a little bit as we always do. And by the way, thank you for all the, you know, the positivity and the love and the energy that you put into the work you do. And when you come on the radio broadcast, you always bring a good vibe to the broadcast. And I know the listeners appreciate it. So thank you, Heather.
Oh, thank you.
So the last two things I want to get into here with you, and then we can, if we have time, we can, you know, go off on whatever other solutions we want to get into. But you wrote this interesting article for Activist Post. This police department just challenged Big Pharma and won. We're rooting for the cops in this one? So explain to me. I we're so used to hearing bad stories about the police that this is actually something quite interesting and different, and I would say good that this police department did against Big Pharma. So could go ahead, take it away. Explain what happened.
Okay. I hope I'm saying this right, but there's a city in Massachusetts or a department named Gloucester, Massachusetts department. They have a drug problem, namely legal prescription drugs. Not always used in a legal way, but, you know, people are addicted to opioids and painkillers. And since it's causing, according to this police department, since it's causing such a problem, and they're also not taking a criminal approach to the people, they decided that if Big Pharma did this, they should help fix it too. So they did was make a simple Facebook statement that drew a lot of attention. They called Big Pharma out and said that they should help, since, according to them, 80% of people addicted to like hardcore street drugs started out with the gateway of painkillers that were legal from Big Pharma. So they posted the top five CEOs and their salaries, which add up into the tens of millions. If you put them all together, it's almost a billion. Which those are just the CEOs. That does not include all the billions and billions that Big Pharma and the pharma family empires make and bring in. But they did that, and they posted their emails and their phone numbers too, along with this. And it got a lot of attention, and it got even better because this police department, Gloucester, started an angel initiative, an angel program, they call it, where they're not going to be punishing drug users if the people come to them for help. If they come and say, I have a drug problem, they're going to help them. And they're not going to arrest them or beat them up or anything like that. And Pfizer actually called them. So we don't know where that's going to go, but Pfizer actually called them and wanted to meet with them. And then the police chief concluded by saying, addiction is a disease. No way are we arresting someone who comes in for help. No way are we judging anyone. And everyone is thrilled. Like, everyone is cheering on this police department. That should tell that if that is any indication of something, how willing people are to praise and commend police when it looks like they're on your side. You know, when it looks like they're doing something to help people instead of bashing in their heads with batons and so-called non-lethal weapons and throwing innocent people in prison, stealing stuff through civil asset forfeiture. The list goes on and on. We hear about that stuff plenty, all the time. But it's sadly just so rare to hear a story like this that it's quite the thrill, and people share it everywhere. So where this leads, we don't know. What does this mean? Not sure. You know, about the initiative going towards the rehabilitation route. I'm suspending my belief, but I'm also commending the action because, like, some people were bashing it and saying, oh, that does not do away with all the other horrible stuff that they do. Then it occurred to me, what if somebody tried to change and the system was changing and then we continue to just beat it down? Like, isn't this what we want, though? We wanted something. We want the war on drugs to end. I'm assuming everyone listening wants the war on drugs to end, criminalizing and hurting people who are addicted, and there's no evidence at all that it helps them in any way. We already know it doesn't help them in any way to be in prison for a drug addiction.
The thing that bothers me is that they, if you look, it's like for opioid painkiller addiction. And as someone who suffers with constant pain myself, I can tell you that there are times that painkillers, opioid painkillers, are the only thing that can take the edge off where you can actually get anything done during the course of the day. So not everybody that has to take painkillers it gets addicted to them. The problem is, it's not like a lot of the things that get blamed are they'll bring up like the easygoing things like Vicodin and stuff, but they never talk about the real hardcore stuff like the oxys. And they push those things on a lot of people. And down here, big fun. Now, see, that's where they should be focusing on certain things like that. Or what about the other stuff, too, the psychotropic medications? How come that's not mentioned? Because that stuff creates an addiction in and of itself, even if it's not something that they would consider to be an addiction. The body gets chemically altered by that stuff. And if you took it away, what happens? A lot of people snap, right? They even the medication says you can't just stop taking it. You need to wean off of it. You know, the doctors will tell you, we're told by the manufacturers you need to wean off it. Look, when the manufacturer is admitting you need to wean off of something, you need to wean off of it. So it's a good start. This police department did it. I just wish that they would have extended it into a few other things. And I hope that it doesn't just stay focused on the opioid painkiller thing. Because Florida did that. They attacked what they call pill mills down here.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of pain clinics. And some of them were legitimate, just pill mills, but a lot of them were real pain clinics. And they would say, well, you write a lot of pain prescriptions to these doctors. And these doctors would be like, well, that's my job. And if you're closing all these other clinics, then you're gonna be consolidating more and more patients into one spot. Anyway, they ended up creating a problem where now these older people in their 60s and in their 70s are getting arrested for buying heroin. Why?
Right.
Because they don't have access to the opioid pain medication that they actually need because they have a hip problem or a back problem or a knee problem or an ankle problem or, you know, shoulder, wrist, whatever. They've had multiple surgeries. And Big Pharma created that. And then it was taken away by law enforcement. You know, this, the war on drugs is a huge problem because I don't think they understand the medical, well, I know they don't understand the medical aspect of what's going on with all of this and addiction. And it's starting to change a little bit, but you know what I mean. Anyway, so you've actually heard about the problem down here in Florida with the older crowd and the opioids, and now they're going to get heroin instead of it?
Well, actually, I know that that's a facet of the war on drugs and the prison for profit industry. This department, even though they talked about painkillers, they zeroed in on heroin and they blamed Big Pharma for it. They said, you created this problem. So I don't know if that's hopeful or not. And I also know,
oh, they zeroed right in on heroin.
They said that we have people not only abusing pills, but going into heroin because of the pills. So that might be some kind of, that might be people reading that might figure out how that happens. And I don't believe in closing those clinics or, you know, taking away people's painkillers or anything like that. It's just the system is like this vicious cycle that is just really out of control, whereas like they could be, you know, it could be a more integrated approach where everything, every resource possible is used to help somebody with pain, but it's not. It's like one or the other. You know, it's like you get this, and if we take it away, you'll be forced on the streets. You know, something that's a very simplified version. But for instance, okay, this department zeroes in on opioids or whatever, but the FDA just approved OxyContin for kids, you know, and it's like, well, we understand children might need help with this and everything, but we're talking about a very heavy duty. I don't care if they reformulated it. This is pretty heavy duty. Well, guess what? This family that is called the OxyContin clan, they just made Forbes' list of the richest U.S. families in the entire U.S. They're worth $14 billion. That's nothing compared to the CEOs who make millions of the pharmaceutical companies I just told you about. $14 billion. That's more than some Bushes, Mellons, and Rockefellers.
Well, I mean, there's your real drug pushers.
Yeah, biggest cartel.
Exactly.
In plain sight.
There's your big drug cartel right there. And you know, it's like I did a show on was it Ambien about a year and a half ago. And I read a couple articles about Ambien, and I was reading off the information about lawsuits and stuff. You know, when it came out after, I think it's 5 years or 6 years, whatever it was, when the patent expired on it, and all their research came out and people could go through it, they knew before they released it that that drug had all these wicked side effects, making people do compulsive things like getting up in the middle of the night and driving, like sleep driving, sleep gambling, sleep sex, sleep. I'm not kidding. Research Ambien and what it does to people. Okay, it's crazy. And I did a whole show about it. They sat down and they crunched the numbers and they realized over the course of 5 years that, you know, they knew they were going to get sued once the truth came out and everything. And they knew that there was going to be a certain amount of deaths and everything related to this. And they figured that even if they paid out, like, you know, say they had to pay out like $500 or even $900 million in settlements, they were going to make, I think at the time they were going to make, it was something like $5 or $6 billion they were going to make over the course of, and I think it was like, maybe it was, I'm getting the number, it was something like maybe $1.5 billion, $2 billion a year over the course of like 5 years. So maybe it was something like that. And they were going to end up making like close to like seven to maybe 10 billion over the course of this 5 years. And they realized that it would have been a little drop in the bucket of compared to what they would have had to pay. Even if they had to pay out $1 billion in total, you know, for you know, death and benefits to these families and paying medical bills, it would have been a drop in the bucket compared to what they were going to make in the long run. So they didn't care. So they released the drug anyway, and they knew they were going to get sued, but they didn't care. They knew people were going to die. They didn't care. They just didn't care. That's one. Now, that's one drug. Imagine if they were going to make like $1 billion, even if it was only $1 billion a year. Say they made $1 billion a year just on Ambien alone over the course of 5 years, right? That's one drug. What about all the other ones they push?
You mean like Chantix, the one that has made men murder their entire families?
Yeah. By the way, you know who they tested that on first?
Who?
The veterans.
Oh, gosh.
I remember when they were giving that out for free years ago. They were like, hey, we're giving out this free medication to quit smoking. And I was like, ah, I'm good. Thanks.
Good thing, because everybody I know who's ever taken it has quite the story to tell me. But nobody really believes me, though, when I say that it literally has made men murder their families. I am not joking. It was reported pretty heavily in 2011, and this is what the FDA proves is safe. But don't even think about eating spices, because those are dangerous, according to the FDA. Don't even think about supplements. Those are dangerous, according to the FDA. Supplements haven't killed anybody, and spices have killed maybe 40 people globally in the last 50 years, but hey, let's irradiate those things, right? They're dangerous. And the two drugs that we've mentioned have probably killed hundreds of people each. Probably killed at least hundreds of people.
Pay that no mind, young lady. Pay that no mind. You can't have a spice, but here's some Ambien. And if you want, you can wash it down with this this pill for anxiety. And by the way, the pill for anxiety will probably give you nightmares, so we'll give you a pill for that. Of course, that pill will probably give you angina, so we'll give you a pill for that. That'll give you headaches, though, so we'll give you another pill for that. That'll give you swollen feet, which is now a new condition called swollen foot syndrome, which we just made up and came out with as I'm talking to you right now. So we're coming up with a pill for that, so we'll send that to you when we produce that. I mean, that's, you know, they get caught coming up with this stuff, too. Like, everything is a condition now. You know, you wake up in the morning and you're, do you wake up in the morning and stretch? Oh my God. And then, you know, that could be a problem. And then the stretching, morning stretch syndrome. That'll be a new meme. Scott Lopez to the main office. Scott Lopez to the main office. Please make that a meme. Morning stretch syndrome. Oh my God. Do you stretch when you wake up? That could be a problem. We need you to buy 4 pills from Pfizer. Take them for 6 months, 7 times a day. It'll only cost you $800 per pill. It'll put you seriously, some of this medication they charge like, I've seen for like 1 month supply of medication, I've seen things $800-$900. And you're like, really? And they're like, yeah, and that's with the insurance discount. What? You know, sometimes I've seen, you know, with better insurance where it's not that expensive, but I've seen with just, you know, sometimes people can only afford the prescription plan things where it like helps cover. Even with those discounts, it's like $800-$900. And that takes off a couple $100. Sometimes it's like $1,100-$1,200 for a 1 month supply of pills. What? Why? If you guys are so interested in helping people, why do you charge so much?
Oh, that is a wonderful point, because all these things are always foisted on people under the guise of helping humanity. I mean, take a look around.
Yeah, they're not
first. Yeah, helping. I mean, first take a look at your fellow man, and then take a look at what they're required to do. I mean, this is not coming from the magnanimous hearts of people who wanted to heal the earth. You know, so I'm sorry, but like, I can't trust that they have my best interests at heart. The thing is, I know good people in every realm, you know, so it really helps. It really helps to, you never want to dehumanize any group of people. But at the same time, when the system as a whole has a checkered past, I do reserve the right to point a finger and say this is wrong and unacceptable. For instance, what kind of moral line do you have to cross to say, oh, this will only cost $500 million when people die from using this? How, at what line have you crossed in the spiritual realm to be able to say that and sleep well at night, you know? So, yeah, I'm not, when it comes to a pharmaceutical company, or corporation, I'm not really gonna beat around the bush, you know?
Snake oil salesmen.
The original ones, right?
Yeah, and
yeah, you know, the real ones.
Well, I mean, the Rockefeller clan started the, you know, what we know as the modern day health system today, and they started as a bunch of snake oil salesmen.
Yeah, they did start as that, and they projected that onto the homeopaths who were thriving in the 1800s in America. They were thriving. They were the main source of attention. If you had a chronic problem, you'd go to a homeopathic hospital or visit a homeopath.
And by the way, I know people said, well, people didn't live as long back then. Well, some people did. I hate to bring this to you. And, you know, they didn't have a problem with cancer like we do nowadays. Just saying. They didn't have a problem with diabetes the way we do nowadays. Just saying. They didn't have a problem with heart disease the way we do nowadays. Just saying. How come it's the common thing that I see at least once or twice a month, 109-year-old person? What's the secret to your longevity, sir or madam? And they always say, well, I drink whiskey, I smoke cigarettes, and I use butter every day, or I eat meat or whatever. And you would think that their diet or whatnot would kill them, but apparently because maybe whatever they're ingesting is cleaner than, maybe their beef comes from some local farmer that they know it's clean or whatever. Whatever the case may be, some of these people are living to be older. These older generations of people are living longer than the newer generations of people. Why is that? Maybe because when they were younger, they were exposed to food that had more nutrition in it.
That's my theory. Yeah, I talk to people about that, and we call it the bank account. We call it the nutritional bank account because they have way more deposits, and we have more withdrawals for everything that we had to eat as kids. When I think about my childhood and not only the food supply, but what I ate at the cafeteria and everything, and I wasn't working on a farm or anything like that, that kind of tells me something, you know. And I was vaccinated as a kid, and just all the stuff that my grandparents didn't do. And one of them lived through the Great Depression, and yet they still came out thriving, you know. So it's that bank account. That's the only thing I can figure. Or another thing is maybe they've got more grit, more grit than I do. I don't know, but.
Yeah, I think it's a lot of it has to do with what we were exposed to when we were kids, you know, through food, nutrition, vaccines, and all that stuff. We only have about 4 minutes left, and I want to get into this other article really quick that you wrote. And
sure.
And I'm just going to urge people to go, because this is a part of the line of, you know, nutrition and everything, and cleaning your body up. I want people to go actually read the article, and then if there's an audio component or not or anything like that, I'll let you get into that. But whatever, I want everybody to go check out this article and the interview you did. So it's what a scientist wants you to know about Alzheimer's, aluminum, and elimination. So I would assume the elimination is the elimination of aluminum from the human body. Go ahead, Heather.
Yes.
Go ahead, 3 minutes.
Okay. I got to interview Dr. Christopher Exley of England. He's of Keele University. He's a PhD. He's spent over 30 years studying aluminum. He pretty much knows everything about it. We are in the age of aluminum, according to him, and he discovered that the reason aluminum was harmful, could be harmful to human beings with the exposure, is because it was extracted out of the environment and it didn't have its partner mineral, silica. So that is that he figured out that that was the key to, basically the key to everything. And these mineral waters have, like Fiji water, has silica in it. So if you drink silicon-rich waters, it will literally safely draw the aluminum out of your blood, according to his hypothesis, out of your brain, and safely into your urine without hurting you, without taking away anything else. That is probably the hugest scientific finding, most mind-blowing thing in my whole life, to think that you could get mineral water. And because you think about it, guys, how much aluminum we get exposed to every day. We're breathing it in, we get injected with it, we're eating it, it's in pills, it's in aspirin, it's in cookware. There's no getting away from it. It's basically the most heavily mined metal, and to think that there is a simple solution hiding in mineral water to be able to safely do that is amazing, that you can actually do that for yourself. And I asked him a bunch of questions. I encourage you to hear this on YouTube, and because I really got him with a lot of questions. Like, some people think diatomaceous earth will do the same thing. That might not be the case.
Okay, so where can they go listen to it on YouTube? Go ahead and plug it really quick.
Okay, I wrote the article, What a Scientist Wants You to Know About Alzheimer's, Aluminum, and Elimination. It's on Natural Blaze from early September, and it's about the same title on YouTube. And there's a picture that says Dr. Christopher Exley. So there's a YouTube interview called Alzheimer's, Aluminum, and Elimination, What a Scientist Wants You to Know. And that's our interview together on YouTube, on the Natural Blaze channel. You can definitely find us that way on YouTube. And also, before, I wanted to tell everyone, if you want to write an article, I would love to see it. If you want to send it to Natural Blaze, that would be contact@naturalblaze.com. You can also send us tips there, too, if you want.
Awesome. Heather, as always, you're just a fabulous guest, and you rock the airwaves for the listeners. Thank you so much, dear.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, go follow her on Twitter. Go listen to the interview on YouTube. Check out Natural Blaze. Check out Activist Post. Make sure you follow Heather's work. And as I always tell you, and as Heather was telling you tonight in her own way, the solutions to our problems are an inside job, meaning you have to look to yourself. So we have to heal ourselves, and then we can go out and we can heal the world. And we can all work together and we can solve the problems. Because obviously the powers that shouldn't be aren't going to, don't want to, and they do not have our best interests at heart. And I know Heather and everybody else that's on this broadcast believes in you. We love you all, and I'll see you all again Thursday with Jim Mars. I'm out.